Hello, Saint Paul. How are you this evening? Good, good, good. So, my name is Saimukta Vongsay, and welcome to the Lowertown Reading Jam. This is the first one of the season, so thank you for being here. So the Lowertown Reading Jam is sponsored by the Saint Paul Almanac. It's good to see you all here. If you're interested, our books are available for purchase right here at the Black Dog Cafe, and I think it's right there by the counter. Can we give a shout out to the Black Dog Cafe and to Sarah for always hosting us here? So the St. Paul Almanac is a literary organization that creates opportunities for understanding, learning, and building relationships through sharing people's stories. We'd like to thank our sponsors. This activity is made possible in part by funds provided by the Lowertown Future Fund of the St. Paul Foundation and support from St. Paul Neighborhood Network. SPNN airs our shows throughout the month on their cable access channel. Shout out to Shelley. And we'd also like to thank Takuma Aiken. He's our incredible artist who draws the action as it is happening. And if you look behind me, you can see all the amazing Lowertown Reading Jam stuff that he's created. And I keep telling him this, I want to steal one, but I won't do it. Tonight's show is curated by Elena Scoop. Elena presents New Griot's Gumbo Revolution. Now I'm going to tell you a little bit about her. She is a visionary and founding member of the Givens Black Writers Retreat Program, who is interested in bridging the gap of what is missing. For her, what was missing was a network of Black diaspora writers to collaborate, connect, and support this writing aesthetic. Elena is a West African dancer, choreographer, poet and playwright who writes dramatic works with social, economic, and historical subject matter driven through personal characters. She is also a Givens Foundation literary artist. Please help me welcome Elena Scoop. Ah, so sorry. Please help me welcome her.
Okay, first correction. All right, so you know, I'm vertically challenged, but that's okay. Hello.
Hello.
I am so excited. Are y'all excited to be here? Because I am. All right, because I sure am. And I'm telling you, you have a treat waiting for you. Thank you, St. Paul Almanac. Thank you, Black Dog. Thank you, Clarence White, for inviting me to do this. I so appreciate you. And I appreciate all the writers and all of you that are here to listen. And so, you know, we have like a very small amount of time. So I'm just gonna, like that. And we're gonna get things going. And I will introduce everyone to you at the very end. But I would say, hold on to your seats. I don't have to worry about y'all falling asleep because you won't, trust me. And you want to hear what they have to say. So sit back and enjoy. Thank you so much. All right.
The bridge. You are inside me, behind me, in front of me, beside me, which is strange, because you are outside walking our invisible dog. You are with me, loving me and holding me and wanting me, which is strange, because I told you that I wanted to be free. There is a place on the other side of where we are now. I will meet you there. There is a hope on the other side of these lost dreams. I will find a little place along hope's shore, where we can go together to dream anew. Don't worry on the days you cannot make it. I will come back as many times as I need to until I find you. If I could write you a poem, if I could write you a poem, it would be long and complicated, like our lives. It would be brave and fierce and warm and loving and patient and kind and true. If I could write you a poem, my poem would be you.
Not to contradict, but I am too much to be a poem. I cannot be expressed as short, sudden leaps or truncated sights. I cannot be culled from languid, lazy, bubbling language or naming simple form and color. I cannot be found in balanced, anchored couplets or a race to the finish in bumpy hills and swimming, rolling weaves. The idea of me is expansive, beyond shape and line, analyzed and reconstructed, tortured in consideration of how I should lay against the curve of the seam, anchored to the margin or scattered, until I shape the chevron the poet has been hoping to achieve. To wish me into a form that can be contained on one page, two at the most, is to hope that I will fill the vessel you mold me in the belief that I am shapeable, knowable, describable. I deserve at least short story. I flex as novella. I manifest in serialization. And I magnify through dream. Even then, you'll just be at the start.
What happens to a bear without claws? A time comes when silence is betrayal. We always are what we do and do not do. It is a hectic time that calls for the personal. Some of us were born into this war as others haven't gotten the memo or looked outside the window and saw the ghosts. There are many ghosts here, too many to count. We coexist, us in the trenches, us the lifeless, us the ones who cannot hide ourselves. Deployed as a nomad in the city of death, in the new planet with no borders but locks and walls everywhere, I walk aimlessly under the stars in the nighttime of my fears. When I see the ghosts, it helps keep me focused, for they keep me company. No idea the day or what the clock says. I look up at night and see thieves in the sky take down the stars, blood still wet like the uncertainty of this new certainty. I have begun to see the exigent circumstance I was made into. It happens when I do this real moron thing called thinking. Blood still wet, like the uncertainty of this new certainty. My conclusions are not always popular or pleasant. I'm all out of cheeks to turn. And the old narrative is out of people to blame. We have no time to clean our boots. The poverty of language is upon us. The sounds are real. The harrowing chants are of the war, like a call for prayer. Everybody wants to get their licks in on the black body. Maybe you forgot. My feet have me looking for allies. Instead, I see the empty eye sockets of hope. We are transfixed by a life where bullets tell the truth, because fear is the only thing that has a voice, but that's an old bloodstain to bet. I am a lifelong soldier in a proxy war, as weapons are old truths. They are being pushed aside by new truths, turning the old truths into new lies. We have a way of speaking languages that kill, but we continue to worship them with complete devotion. They are our deity. We miss home. We miss home. Oh yeah, we miss home. I guess this is the sound of life and war, or some space that goes unchecked. The winds of this decade blowing us to the land of no future. We stuck here where one can hear the crackle of the universe, and we are all one. Our weapons are the words in which we worship with devotion. We stuck loving illusions, loyal to language that fail us miserably. Loyal to business as usual, in other words, in unsaids, in words, in unsaids that asphyxiate, that leave us lifeless. Maybe you forgot. We seem not just apathetic, but naive enough to believe that our choices are apolitical. I'll say that again. In 2013, we seem not just apathetic, but naive enough to believe that our choices are apolitical. In human organization, no choice ever is. Thank you.
So, I guess y'all might be wondering what this is. It's an empty jar. So, I need your help in filling this empty jar. Let's see here. It says tips for the artist, tips for Saint Paul Almanac. So, in a few minutes, we'll be passing this around. But don't forget about this empty jar that I need you to help fill. I'm just saying, okay? Another thing, I want to do a quick announcement. Murray, who is about to do another piece, is doing late night series at Pillsbury House November 16th. Hey! So I need you all to come and show your represent and support for Murray. And then there's also something that Marcus is doing 2014, May 3rd, and I'll read more about that later. But for now, we're about to start Murray's piece, so I'm going to get out the way. Don't forget the empty jar. I'm just saying. Okay.
So I'm going to try an experiment, which isn't an experiment, but it's an experiment here. So we'll see. For people who don't know what late night is,
okay, so I need that black something, something to, what's that, secret black Batman? I need that secret Batman. That's the word. That's the word. The secret Batman. I need that. That was a cue.
hopefully Batman knows what that means. For people who don't know, late night happens over at Pillsbury House in the fall. There's usually three nights. And I think one of the best parts is it's an opportunity for artists to experiment. But for the audience, I think the best part is that you get fed. Food's at 8, and then the show is at 9, and the show goes until 11 or until it's done. But you're seeing new work and people trying new stuff. So if you... there's actually three. There's November 2nd, November 9th, and I'm up on the 16th. You ready, madam? Okay. American art. Pride reigns first. How is it that I live in a country where to apologize is the lowest thing one can do? How is it that I live in a country where pride and infallibility, even when false, is more important than truth, than relationship, than the future viability of how we are here together with each other? How is it that pride reigns first? Past wrongs didn't really happen that way, and more importantly, do not matter in the now. How is it that the only humans our country, government, corporation, and the great white hope? How is it that I live in a country where many of us, we must eat dirt and grin because others' pride and saved face is more important than our humanity? How is it that I live in a country where acts of terrorism historically and regularly practiced on some of us inside the borders become massively criminal and immediately prosecutable when someone else comes knocking at the door? How is it that I live in a place where country, government, corporation, all dreams and ideas born of humans, even humans ourselves, cannot be human, cannot be wrong, cannot change, cannot express regret, cannot think of others? How is it that I live in a country where, once again, we are the people out on the plains? We promise Native Americans, we promise the Palestinians, the poor of Appalachia, their autonomy, their liberty, their lives without interference, until we realize that we need where we have promised to leave them alone. How is it that I live in a country where nobody is willing to say they are sorry, and that what they or their company or their ancestors or our government or what our country did and does in other countries, to other countries, companies, people's spirits, and souls is wrong? Wrong. Wrong. It's evil, self-serving, and unkind. How is it that I live in a country that I love and I die with shame to be a part of every day? How is it I live in a country where art is a dirty word unless it is to gain, to grow, to triumph over others? The art of the deal, the art of negotiation, the art of conflict, the art of war.
They met in 1956, a black man and a white woman in the old Rondo neighborhood of St. Paul, at a small church that's no longer there, north of Interstate 94.
She had graduated from Moody Bible Institute and was starting nurses training at Hamlin to become a missionary. He was in seminary school at Northwestern Bible College to become a minister, then head back home to Philadelphia and start his own church. She taught Sunday school at that small church that is no longer there, north of Interstate 94. He was interning under the tutelage of Leroy Gardner, Sr. She wondered where he went when church services were through. He had no idea she was interested until she called. Bill and Hilda. My mom starts the story of how she met my dad. I pursued him. I wondered where he went after church. Where does he live? With a smile on her face, I can see her watching Dad walk down Rondo Avenue. We were going through her old scrapbook that she made, handmade. It held cards that her and Dad sent to each other with handwritten Bible verses on them. One card had a long letter from Mom. She'd gone home to Menominee, Wisconsin to visit her family. She explained that what was happening at home, who she had seen, friends, and such. But she was confused because they were sorry they weren't able to find a nice white boy for her. They were sorry that she was dating a black man. She was confused because she loved her family and her friends, but she also loved Bill, my dad. She wrote in the letter, "I love you, Bill." Dad said he didn't want to force her to choose him. He wanted her to make this decision on her own. He loved her and hoped she loved him. You love who you love. They married on September 1st, 1958. Their wedding picture sits on my desk at work. It's a black and white. Holding hands, their smiles big and proud. Mom dressed in a T-length dress with a boat neckline. Sheer, 3/4-inch sleeves. Holding a Bible wrapped in ribbons in her left hand. Dad is dressed in a white dinner jacket with black slacks and a bow tie, looking very Sidney Poitier in Guess Who's Coming to Dinner. They are standing in front of the church steps. Mom tells me what we don't see in the picture. To the right of the picture, a group of white people who have gathered on the boulevard across the street. A group of men, women, girls, and boys watching my parents' wedding party, friends and family leave the church. No harsh words were said, just the typical Minnesota gawking and looking. This was 1958 in Minnesota. It may not have been against the law for interracial couples to marry, but it was rare to see a couple getting married. And someone must have minded, because the windows of the church were broken out that night. My parents were married almost 50 years. They've come from different races, but they were meant for each other. They ate the same food, were not afraid to go out on a limb for someone, and deeply believed that justice was for all. They were not afraid to cross the color line to see someone like themselves. Beacon. It was the end where I started to see my parents. I'd seen them so many times before, but when Kim died, I saw them as individuals, their own person, grieving and coping, each in their own way. I saw them and knew I couldn't be hurtful to them much longer. See, at age 14, I wanted to curse and swear and not follow the rules, be in by dark, regardless of the season. Homework first, play later. No, you can't go out. I don't care what you told them. Most of us remember this well, the trials of teenage years. I was ugly and mean to them when I wanted to be. But the seeing never went away. The sight of my parents as human beings with feelings, dreams, aspirations, it was clear to me, and it only got clearer. My dad and I became good friends, and I became my mother's confidant. She missed my sister Kim terribly. Well, they both did, but Mom was more demonstrative, crying at the dinner table over tater tot hash dish and listening to Phil Donahue, or singing hymns at church. Dad was more inward, methodical, grief group and counseling, an occasional hello, Kim, to a picture on the wall. But I saw them. They were hurting. They lost one of their own. This was different from baby boy Young, our oldest brother, firstborn, born dead. They didn't know baby boy Young. They had hopes for him, they had dreams for him, and yes, but they knew Kim. She was theirs for 15 years, 3 months, 23 days, 5 hours, and 10 minutes. They watched her grow. They saw her become her own person, from sucking her fingers and carrying a doll to a determined, I don't care if you like me or not, young girl wearing full afro and Levi bell-bottom corduroys. They watched her get sick, and they tried to make her life normal. They tried to save her, keep her here with us. I saw they loved her and lost. They stayed together because where else would they go? My 14-year-old eyes saw this, but I didn't know that they would become a beacon. Thank you.
Hotep, everyone. I'm Wisdom. I'm going to be reading a couple poems from the She Suite. She speaks from the four corners of the world, a short collection of poetry. Nighttime, she speaks of resilience. The sun won't set. The gas was turned off. Water cold, so was the stove. Back door kicked in again. Bereaved and loved, grandma's faux pearls, brooch, and handkerchief stolen too. And aw, damn, the rent's due. But the sun won't set. Her children won't go cold nor hungry. Her sleep will only intermittently be broken. Grandma's memory and love are permanent, like the sunshine, even when the earth tilts away to permit night. The sun always, always shines, and so will her soul, her people. The sun won't set. I wonder why you come for me. She speaks of the fall and her assigned protector's betrayal. I wonder why you come with me, come for me. Your once silken hands, now iron fist, and you come for me. Your vision dim from the world's fog and calamity, your walk staggered, your yoke heavy, and you come for me. On the purple hibiscus I held out to you, slapping the healing out of me, and even further from your needy reach, you come for me. I wonder why you come for me when I draw your bath of lavender, oats, and honey. Has my sure composure to life's unwinding caused your contempt? Surely I have not made the ground crumble in Haiti and added insult to your hunger. And yet you come for me. Why should I fear your coming when I await your arise? Your plight has always been mine. I put you to bed, held your hand, gave you myself, drew pain from your tip. But night brings your insecurity to tear at the hole in this American Red Cross tent, to tear at the wholeness of me, it seems, in vain effort to regain your footing. But your strength is not found on my back. It is in my hand. So I wonder why you come for me.
Good evening. If you're alive, say yeah.
Yeah.
I'm Marcus Hawkins. North Minneapolis is in the building. Right. I want to livicate this essay to my father, who passed away on May 21st this summer, and also my unshaven face. It's called The Missing Class Ain't the Middle Class. I hate how politicians and corporate media pundits always speak empty rhetoric about the so-called middle class, especially during election seasons, but never mention the missing class, the millions of Americans who ain't living below the, quote, official, unquote, federal poverty guidelines, which publicly define who is poor in America. Members of the missing class are struggling to get by. We're not living comfortably. If you're in the missing class, you don't qualify for much, if any, public assistance. Yet most Americans lack viable prospects for a high quality of life in terms of economic opportunities, such as the means to be able to afford quality housing, rising costs of transportation, nutritious food in underserved environments, college tuition, and unaffordable retirements without low-income public benefits, i.e. government assistance. Plutocratic politicians disparagingly call it so-called entitlements. Most members of the missing class tend to be economically disadvantaged, obviously, because they don't earn enough income to fully make ends meet, and most do indeed work. The working poor and or low and moderate income earners are too often left out of the mainstream political discourse, in the mass media, public policy forums, and legislative processes. With half of our country classified as poor or low income today, our economists, educators, journalists, politicians, artists, entertainers, and all other citizens with influence, we all need to change our individual and collective economic paradigms. We all must incessantly speak the truth about the state of our economy. Let's collectively change the hearts and minds of the masses about prioritizing economic justice. Let's make major grassroots moves in America, organizing this richest nation on earth for the sake of the so-called common good. Let's make a more cooperative and less competitive economy, locally, nationally, and globally, people. And let me manage everyone's expectations by acknowledging that our world doesn't need equality, no. But if we want our world to be sustainable, then humanity's interests must be served equitably, for crying out loud. Let's release the grip the corporate mass media, entertainment industry, and political elite have on our hearts and minds. Let's think critically and independently. Log off of social media and unplug from your technologies and pay attention. Every national economy needs a thriving middle class, but mainstream Americans in the U.S. tend to be too apathetic, so materialistic and individualistic that we generally are disinterested in economic equity and justice issues, especially for those people we don't know, for those people we perceive are different, for those people we truly don't care about. The missing class majority tends to get ignored or treated as footnotes at best in politics, implicated as being failures in life, or more politely, as unsuccessful in this world based on their socioeconomic status, effectively dismissed as irrelevant in the political economy by the privileged politicians who promote so-called class warfare. So let's ask and answer the difficult questions, y'all. What on earth does a supposedly low unemployment rate mean when it's only including people defined as so-called participants in the labor market, excluding the long-term unemployed and disenfranchised? What are the real unemployment and underemployment rates in America? Concentrating on the government's unemployment rate instead of income and wealth inequality and the consequences of an unaffordable cost of living misleads the public because it paints a fictional picture. It paints a fictional picture of our national economic health in America. We collectively have enough wealth as a nation, but we need to prioritize and focus on what matters most. How many people cannot and do not earn a real livable wage income? How many people don't have access to adequate health care, food justice, housing justice, and education equity? Can we really afford the military and prison industrial complexes? Can we afford to perpetuate historical racial disparities in a growing underclass? I hate hearing political grandstanding yapping about about job creation with sensationalized sound bites and buzzwords, yet a lack of substance, a lack of honesty, and intellectual integrity. The power-hungry, privileged politicians, economists, and lobbyists who prioritize big businesses profiting over the people, they prefer glossing over the facts, the rough facts that job growth with unlivable wages is unimpressive, that low-income jobs are inadequate. The reality is that the romantic pop culture narrative of the American dream is illusionary or evasive for the majority of people who will die in the same economic class that they were born and raised in. I hate to break it to you, but there will never be enough sustainable living wage job opportunities for the majority of Americans to make it to and remain in the so-called middle class. What on earth is that? So what do we, the people, do about the struggles of the missing class?
Sacrifice, she speaks of loyalty and deadly silence. I hold your unsacred secret safe, refusing to flashlight your exploitation or have you see a ghost of your reflection in your shaving mirror at 2 a.m. I will continue to be the swollen belly, starving and not pregnant, behind your dignified name. Empathy silences my baboon's scream. After all, the scent of a woman is delicious. It is sweet, sweet, soul-satisfying candy yams, pulsing baked macaroni cheese, tender roasts, vinegar and jalapeno greens in our throats. Our plate is full, and your deprivation has been your and my curse since your creation. Eve was given to Adam without consent. Meanwhile, I tease peacock feathers in my hair, enjoyed your appreciative stare. I thought you admired my feathers, naive. You snatched them out, stuffed them in my mouth while polishing my bones. I bit you, leaving my teeth traced on your skin, but would not show the world you were grizzly instead of teddy, would not show the world I was victim instead of victor. I put our secret in my pocket against a bruise that won't heal. And sometimes when you lean your weight on it, Lilith yells, beware. Tell your lover you are Earth too. She is not as understanding as I, nor Eve. She knows no compromise, comprehends no unholy sacrifice. So as I bid you good night, I beg, sleep light.
Patty cake. This story is not about pain. This story is not about pain. This story is about me and my sister. This story, patty cake. patty cake. This story is about how my sister lost her virginity when she was not ready to lose her virginity. This story,
patty cake.
This story is about my sister and me. This story is about my sister.
Patty cake.
This story is about how my sister disappeared before My eyes, patty cake, patty cake, patty cake, patty cake, patty cake. My sister, Patty.
Say Jax. That's me, Jax. Sister.
Y'all remember when you used to play Jax? And you remember when you used to patty cake? This story is about my sister. And how she lost her virginity and I was not there. And how she forgave me. This story is about 40 years later. My sister is still my sister and my best friend. And this story is about how blood is thicker than water. How my sister and me are still sisters. Now, I wonder what that looks like on my Facebook timeline. Okay, so y'all remember the empty jar? So I'm about to pass the empty jar around, and I'm really hoping that it's so heavy I can't even lift it. Then I'm gonna have to get Nigel or somebody to come help me lift it. So if y'all can help us out and help St. Paul Almanac, because a lot of people here volunteer their work and their time. So if you can just help out, I'm just gonna pass, you know, how you doing, church? Gonna pass the basket. Okay, we're gonna pass the jar.
The future looks good. Ezin Ma fumbles the keys against the lock and doesn't see what came behind her. Her father, as a boy, when he was still tender, vying for his mother's affections. Her grandmother, overworked to the bone by the women whose houses she dusted, whose laundry she washed, whose children's houses she scrubbed cleaned. Overworked by the bones of a husband who wanted many sons and the men she entertained to give them to him, sees her son to his 13th year with the perfunction of a nurse and dies in her bed with a long, weary sigh. His stepmother regards him as one would a stray dog that came by often enough that she knew its face, but she'd be damned if she let him in. They dance around each other, boy waltzing forward with want, woman pirouetting away. She'd grown up the eldest child of too many and knew how the needs of a child can drown out a girl's dreams. The boy sees only the turn back, the dismissal, and the father ignores it all, blinded by the delight of an old man with a young wife still fresh between her legs. This one he won't share. And when the boy is 15 and returns from the market where he sold metal scraps to find his possessions in two plastic bags on the front doorstep, he doesn't even knock to find out why or ask where he's supposed to go, but squats in an abandoned half-built bungalow he shares with other unmothered boys, where his two best shirts are stolen and he learns to carry his money with him at all times. He begs, he sells scrap metal, he steals, and the third becomes his way out. He starts small, with picked pockets and goods snatched from poorly tended market stalls. He learns to pick locks, to hotwire cars, and finesse his sleight of hand. When he is 21, the war comes to Nigeria, and while people are cheering in the streets and shouting, "Biafra, Biafra," he begins to stockpile goods. When goods become scarce, he makes his fortune. When food becomes scarce, he raids farms in the dead of night, which is where he will meet his wife, and why Ezinma, fumbling the keys against the lock, doesn't see what came behind her. Her mother, at age 22, not beautiful, but with the fresh look of a person who has never been hungry. She is a brash girl who takes more than is offered. It is 1966, months before everything changes, and she is at a party hosted by friends of her parents, and there is a man there, yellow skin like a mango, and square-jawed, and body like the statue of David, wealthy. The unmarried women strap on their weaponry, winsome smiles, robust cleavage, accommodating personalities, and go to war over him. When she comes out the victor, she takes it as her due. Almost a year into their courting, the war comes. Her people are Biafra loyalists. His people think Ojukwu is a fool. On the night of their engagement party, only her people attend. And when she goes by his house the next day, she discovers he has left the country. Her family is soon forced to flee the city, soon forced to barter what they have been able to carry, soon forced to near begging, and for the first time in her life, food is so scarce she slips into farms at night and harvests tender tubes of half-grown corn in stealth, and they boil so soft she eats the inner core and fibrous husk too. One night, she finds a small farm tucked behind a hill, and there she encounters a man stealing the new yams that would have been hers. There is no competition. He's well-fed and strong, and even if she tries to raise an alarm out of spite, he could silence her. But he puts a finger to his lips and gives her a yam. And being her, she gestures for two more. He gives her another one, and she scurries away. The next night, when she returns to the farm, he is waiting for her. She sits by him, and they listen to crickets and each other's breathing. When he puts his arm around her, she leans into him and cries for the first time since her engagement party many months ago. When he puts a yam in her lap, she laughs. And when he takes her hand, she thinks, "I am worth three yams." She will have two daughters. The first she names Biafra out of spite, as though to say, "Look, mother, pin your hopes onto another fragile thing." And the second is named after her mother, who has since died and doesn't know that her daughter will forgive her for choosing the wrong side, and name her daughter, her youngest child, Ezinma, who fumbles the keys against the lock and doesn't see what came behind her. Her sister, whom everyone has taken to calling Bibi, because what nonsense to name a child after a country that doesn't exist. Bibi, who is beautiful in her way her mother never was. Bibi, stubborn like her mother was always. They fought since Bibi was in the womb, lying so heavy in her mother's cervix a light jog could have jostled her out. Bedridden, Bibi's mother grew to resent her and stewed so hot the child should have boiled in her belly. And 3 years later, Ezinma, pretty, yes, but in that manageable way that causes little offense. She is a ghost of Bibi, pale in tone and personality, but sweet in the way that Bibi can be only when Bibi wants something. Bibi loathes her. No, Ezinma can't play with Bibi's toys. No, Ezinma can't walk with Bibi and her friends to school. No, Ezinma can't have a pad, so just have to wad up tissues and deal with it. Ezima grows up yearning for her sister's affection. When Bibi is 21 and in the university and her parents are struggling to pay the school fees, Bibi meets Godwin, yellow-skinned and square-jawed like his father, and falls in love. She falls harder when her mother warns her away. And when her mother presses, saying, "You don't know what his people are like," "I do," Bibi responds, "You're just angry and bitter that I have a better man than you." And her mother slaps her, and that's the end of that conversation. Ezima serves as a go-between, a role she's been shanghaied into since her youth, and keeps Bibi appraised of all the family news, despite her mother's demands to cut her off. And Godwin is a better provider than Bibi's father, who is now a modest trader. He rents her a flat, he lends her her car, he blinds her with a constellation of gifts, things she's never had before, like spending money and orgasms. The one time she brings up marriage, he walks out and she can't reach him for 12 days. 12 days that put the contents of her bank account in stark relief. 12 days where she sits in the flat that's in his name, drives the car also in his name, and wonders what is so precious about this name he won't give to her. And when he finally returns to see her packing and grabs her hair, pulling, screaming that even this is his, she is struck by his fist, yes, but also by the realization that maybe her mother was right. The reunion isn't tender. Bibi's right eye is almost swollen shut, and her mother's mouth is pressed shut, and they neither look at or speak to each other. Her father, who could never bear the tension between the two women, the memories of his turbulent childhood brought back, squeezes Bibi's shoulder, then leaves, and it is that gentle pressure that starts her tears. Soon she is sobbing, and her mother is still stone-faced, but it is a wet face that she turns away so no one can see. Ezima takes Bibi to the bathroom, the one they've shared and fought over since they were old enough to speak. She sits her on the toilet lid and begins to clean around her bruises. When she is done, it looks terrible. When Bibi stands to examine her face, they are both in the mirror. "I still look terrible," Bibi says. "Yes, you do," Ezima replies, and they are soon laughing, and in their reflection, they notice for the first time that they have the exact same smile. How have they gone this long without seeing that? Neither knows. Bibi worries about her things that are still in the flat. Ezima says not to worry, that she will get them. "Why are you still nice to me?" Bibi wants to know. "Habit," Ezima replies. Bibi thinks about it for a moment, then says something she's never said to her sister. "Thank you." Which is why Ezima, fumbling the keys against the lock, doesn't see who came behind her. Godwin, who grew up under his father's corrosive indulgence. Godwin, so unused to hearing no, it hit him like a wave of acid, dissolving the superficial decency that accompanies a person who always gets his way. Godwin, who broke his cello when he discovered his younger brother could play it better, which is why he came to be here, watching Ezima, looking so much like her sister from behind, fumbling the unfamiliar keys against the lock of Bibi's apartment so she doesn't see who comes behind her. Godwin, with a gun, he fires into her back.
If Hope was a woman, she would not be thin. She would be thick from all the possibilities that bloomed within. There would be a gap between her front teeth, a large one, not small, just the right size so her nature would slip up and out onto us all. And she would have full lips for speaking the truth. And her hair, no matter what style she chose to wear it in, would always be natural. If Hope was a woman, she might be pregnant, but she might be not. No matter what state of motherhood we found her in, we would know that she had birthed herself a nation and made it great. And if you ask her things like when or where or how, you might find it difficult to pin her down. But if you ask her to embrace you, she would drop everything she was doing, and she would hold you, my friend, like you have never been held before. All of this would be if Hope was a woman. And you know what? She is.
The idea of me is expansive, analyzed in reconstruction, tortured in consideration of how I should lay against the curve of the seam, anchored to the margin or scattered until I shape the chevron, the poet.
Everybody wants to get their licks in on the black body. Maybe you forgot. Everybody wants to get their licks in.
You love who you love. They became a beacon. Love who you love. They became
a beacon. I wonder why you come for me. Your once silken hands, now iron fists.
You forgot.
The missing class ain't the middle class. What do we, the people, do about the struggles of the missing class?
Patty cake, me and my sister, this story is not about my sister.
They dance around each other, boy waltzing forward with want, woman pirouetting away.
If Hope was a woman, she would not be thin. She would be thick from all the possibilities that come.
New griots. We are new griots. And with that comes a revolution. We are new griots. Hawana, Murray, Kirk, Lori, Wisdom, Marcus, Leslie. Okay, and me.
That's right.
While the whole show was going on, for those of you that don't know, we have Takumba Aiken, who has been drawing the artists live and the performers, and this is what he came up with. Isn't that fantastic? So, give him a round of applause. All that was going on while we was doing all that stuff. So, thank you. Yes. Thank you. Okay, and then when they open up the curtains again, you'll see more of his work from the other Lowertown Jams. So, thank you so much.